Good morning, my brothers and sisters in Christ. God has gifted us with another day of life. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Morning prayer begins on page 32 in our opening sentence and continues on page 35 and following in our books of common prayer. Let me hear of your loving kindness in the morning, for I put my trust in you. Show me the road that I must walk, for I lift up my soul to you. Hear us, O Lord, for your mercy is great. We will exalt you, O God, our Savior, and praise your name forever and ever. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. We pray together. Father, we come together in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, to offer you our worship, praise, and thanksgiving. To you belong all power and glory. You are the source of all goodness. Let our worship bear witness to your peace and saving power. Through your Spirit, may we ever rejoice in the abiding presence of our risen and ascended Lord. Amen. The Jubilate. Oh, shout to the Lord in triumph, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness and come before his face with songs of joy. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Come into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him, and bless his holy name. For the Lord is good, his loving mercy is forever, his faithfulness throughout all generations. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Let us take a moment of silence to reflect on those ways in which we have fallen short of God's expectations of us. Things that we did that we ought not have done, and those things we didn't do that God desired us to do. And let us now bring before God those things that are on our consciences, and let us confess our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone, and so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Set us free, O God, from the bondage of our sins, and give us the liberty of that abundant life which you have made known to us in your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. And now we come to the Psalm 89, the prescribed psalm for this morning, part 1, verses 1 to 18. Let us recite the psalm together. Your love, O Lord, forever will I sing. From age to age, my mouth will proclaim your faithfulness. For I am persuaded that your love is established forever. You have set your faithfulness firmly in the heavens. I have made a covenant with my chosen one. I have sworn an oath to David, my servant. I will establish your line forever and preserve your throne for all generations. The heavens bear witness to your wonders, O Lord, and to your faithfulness in the assembly of the holy ones. For who in the skies can be compared to the Lord? Who is like the Lord among the gods? God is much to be feared in the council of the holy ones, great and terrible to all those about him. Who is like you, Lord God of hosts? O mighty Lord, your faithfulness is all round you. You rule the raging of the sea and still the surging of his waves. You've crushed Rahab of the deep with a deadly wound. You've scattered your enemies with your mighty arm. Yours are the heavens, the earth also is yours. You laid the foundations of the world and all that is in it. You've made the north and the south. Tabor and Hermon rejoice in your name. You have a mighty arm. Strong is your hand and high is your right hand. Righteousness and justice are the foundations of your throne. Love and truth go before your face. Happy are the people who know the festal shout. They walk, O Lord, in the light of your presence. They rejoice daily in your name. They are jubilant in your righteousness. For you are the glory of their strength, and by your favor our might is exalted. Truly the Lord is our ruler. The Holy One of Israel is our King. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Amen. Our first reading is taken from the book of 2 Samuel, chapter 13, verses 23 to 39. After two full years, Absalom had sheep shearers at Baal-hazor, which is near Ephraim, and Absalom invited all the king's sons. Absalom came to the king and said, "Your servant has sheep shearers. Will the king and his servants please go with your servant?" But the king said to Absalom, "No, my son, let us not all go, or else we will be burdensome to you." He pressed him, but he would not go, but gave him his blessing. Then Absalom said, "If not, please let my brother Amnon go with us." The king said to him, "Why should he go with you?" But Absalom pressed him until he let Amnon and all the king's sons go with him. Absalom made a feast like a king's feast. Then Absalom commanded his servants, "Watch when Amnon's heart is merry with wine. And when I say to you, strike Amnon, then kill him. Do not be afraid. Have I not myself commanded you? Be courageous and valiant." So the servants of Absalom did to Amnon as Absalom had commanded. Then all the king's sons rose and each mounted his mule and fled. While they were on the way, the report came to David that Absalom had killed all the king's sons, and not one of them was left. The king rose, tore his garments, and lay on the ground, and all his servants who were standing by tore their garments. But Jonadab, the son of David's brother Shimeah, said, "Let not my lord suppose that they have killed all the young men, the king's sons. Amnon alone is dead. This has been determined by Absalom from the day Amnon raped his sister Tamar. Now therefore, do not let my lord the king take it to heart as if all the king's sons were dead, for Amnon alone is dead." But Absalom fled. When the young man who kept the watch looked up, he saw many people coming from the Heronim road by the side of the mountain. Jonadab said to the king, "See, the king's sons have come, as your servant said. So it has come about." As soon as he had finished speaking, the king's sons arrived and raised their voices and wept, and the king and all his servants also wept very bitterly. But Absalom fled and went to Talmai, son of Amihud, king of Geshur. David mourned for his son day after day. Absalom, having fled to Geshur, stayed there for 3 years. And the heart of the king went out, yearning for Absalom, for he was now consoled over the death of Amnon. This is the end of the reading. Thanks be to God. So we continue with our canticle, and the canticle for this morning, we will choose the Song of the Redeemed on page 53 of our Books of Common Prayer. O ruler of the universe, Lord God, great deeds are they that you have done, surpassing human understanding. Your ways are ways of righteousness and truth, O King of all the ages. Who can fail to do you homage, Lord, and sing the praises of your name? For you only are the Holy One. All the nations will draw near and fall down before you, because your just and holy works have been revealed. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. And now we will continue with the second reading, which is taken from the Gospel of Mark. We are reading from Mark chapter 9, verses 42 to 50. Jesus continued, "If any of you put a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for you if a great millstone were hung around your neck and you were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life maimed than to have two hands and go to hell, to the unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life lame than to have 2 feet and to be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have 2 eyes and to be thrown into hell, where their worm never dies and the fire is never quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its saltiness, how can you season it? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another." This is the end of the reading. Thanks be to God. And so we briefly share our thoughts on this reading from the Gospel of Mark that has been assigned for us today. Perhaps we might refer briefly to some of the things that have happened before. We've had the Transfiguration, and Jesus has come down with his disciples from the mountain, and there Jesus healed this boy who had the spirit that cast him down. And now, following that, Jesus was speaking to his disciples about his death and resurrection, pointing them to where they were heading, that final showdown. And then we have this incident where the disciples arguing among themselves about who is the greatest. And then, just before we started our reading this morning, we have the case of a person who the disciples found out was carrying out miracles in the name of Jesus, but he was not one of the disciples. And there Jesus had to explain to them that, you know, he's on my side. Once he's using my name and so on, he's on my side. He can't very well use my name to perform miracles and then be on the other side, be against me. So this basically is what we have in mind, especially those two last incidents, as Jesus talks now in this portion from Mark chapter 9, verses 42 to 50. Jesus is not mincing words at all as he speaks to his disciples. You see, they have been talking about who is the greatest and arguing among themselves. They're talking about people who they want to throw out. This fellow wasn't one of their disciples, so they wanted him out. You know, they're looking for authority and position. But Jesus is now bringing them back down to earth, as it were. And speaking to us as well, let's face it, very bluntly, very clearly. If any of you put a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, you will be in big trouble. You know, it would be better for you if somebody put a millstone around your neck, and a millstone is a huge stone. And there were two stones usually of that size, and you know, they were used together for crushing grain and so on. That was like the mill of the time, two millstones. And very heavy, of course. So it would be better if you had a millstone tied around your neck and you were cast into the sea. And as terrible as that sounds, that is how the Romans actually executed some criminals, you know. So that terrible fate, you know, for someone to have a millstone tied around their neck and cast into the sea and to die that way, what a terrible fate. But that would be better for you. That would have been a much better fate for you than what will follow if you cause one of my little ones. The little ones in this case meaning those who are weak kind of faith, right? Those who are still growing in the faith. So Jesus is saying, your job is to really guide them. And so that's our job too, to guide those who are young in the faith, not less mature than we are in the faith. Your job is to guide them, not to do anything that will cause them to fall into sin. And if you do that, your faith is worse than someone who is killed by having a millstone around his neck and he's thrown into the sea. Terrible. Jesus is now talking about that great responsibility we have. And there are ways we have to be very careful that, you know, we don't cause others, not merely younger children, but less mature Christians as well, from going the wrong way, from falling into sin. Sometimes, you know, in simple ways, we're not thinking and we encourage persons into sin. We might encourage them to cheat. And it's a simple case like a parent, you know, doing the homework for the child instead of just trying to explain it to the child, doing the assignments, you know, or getting someone to do it. These things happen all the time and they're not considered to be anything really serious, but that's really cheating. You know, when we encourage others to cheat, people are working in places and invariably they just take things from where they are. And are we present? Are we, in fact, part of the whole thing and encouraging others? You know, there are many ways in which we encourage others to fall into sin. And Jesus is making it very clear, you know. You know, are we encouraging people as they come, as they hold grudges against others? Are we sort of encouraging them and condoning them in this lack of forgiveness and even in spiteful action? All the little ways, you know. Are we encouraging people to be dishonest, to tell lies? You know, are we part of encouraging others in manipulating financials wherever we might be? You know, what are the things that we are doing? Are we, you know, luring others into sexual sin? Whatever. But Jesus warns us that if we have anything to do with causing those less mature, not necessarily younger, but less mature in the faith, to sin, if we in any way do things that encourage them into sin or lure them into sin, our fate will be worse than someone who has a millstone tied around his neck and thrown into the sea. And that's, you know, I think very chastening for the disciples who are so concerned and arguing about who will be the greatest among them. It's very chastening that Jesus is pointing them to that awesome responsibility that they have. And we too, as more mature Christians who consider ourselves to be more mature Christians, we too have to be extremely careful about how we, you know, how we might be encouraging others into sin or leading them into sin. Perhaps, you know, we too, by the things we do in our own lives, our own behavior, others less mature are seeing us. And they're saying, well, if he could do it, you know, in Trinidad, we said, if he could do it, well, I can do it too. We lower the barrier to sin for others when we are blatantly as well. Well, blatantly or not, when we ourselves are committing sin and others less mature in the faith can see us. So we have to be very concerned in our own conduct as to whether we might indeed be, you know, causing others to fall into sin. And Jesus continues, you know, that, you know, whatever it is that is standing in the way of your living this life of righteousness, you have to get rid of it. If it's your hand, and your hand stands for the things you want to do, so if it's things you want to do as represented by your hand, or places you want to go, if it's your foot that's going to cause you to sin, you know, or the things you want to see, and you think of pornography and all these other kinds of things, if it's the things you want to see, then, you know, represented by your eye, then you should get rid of the hand, things you want to do, get rid of the foot, places you want to go that will lead you into sin, get rid of the eye, if the eye is it will lead you into wanting to see and certain things that you shouldn't. So get rid of whatever is in you. These are the examples Jesus uses. But whatever is in you that is leading you into sin, it would be better for you to cut it off, get rid of it, than to allow it to lead you into sin. Even something as God given as your hand, your foot, and your eyes. It might be a friendship, a relationship. If that is what is leading you into sin, you have to get rid of it. If it's some possession of yours, maybe your car that you worship, and that's the be-all and the end-all for you, then if that's separating you from God, causing you to sin, get rid of it. And so that's the point Jesus is making. Whatever is in the way, you should get rid of it. Because you know what's the alternative of sin? Following a life of sin and allowing these things to keep us into sin, in the sinful ways? You know what's the consequence of that? Hell. There's hell that awaits us. And Jesus says, in that place, of course, the worm never dies and the fire is never quenched. It's a place of punishment. It's a place of misery. You know, it's a place of deep regret, because we from the scriptures we have Lazarus. At Lazarus we have the rich man who didn't help Lazarus in his time. You know, he could see and he was regretting all that he didn't do. And so it is. We'll be with us in hell. We'll be away from God. Away from God. Always regretting all the ways in which we did not follow God. So hell will be pure. Just the absence of God alone is enough misery. And then, of course, the fire, the unquenchable fire, the suffering and the pain, mental and physical, that we experience in the absence of God is what hell really is. And that's the alternative neither none of us would like to have. So Jesus says, you know, continues in the story, well, you know, one of the things that will happen is that everyone will be salted with fire. Salt purifies, you know. Bacteria and so on cannot exist in the midst of a salt solution. So it is a preservative in that sense. So he's saying everyone will be salted with fire. Fire also purifies. So what Jesus is saying to us is, yes, in life there'll be lots of, there'll be suffering, there'll be trials, there'll be temptations, there'll be suffering. But all of this that God will give us will strengthen us and purify us. So we'll be, you know, more able to live out the kind of life that we have. So the suffering will be a very much part of our, what shall I say, our preparation, our strengthening in the faith. So we must not, you know, when the suffering comes and the trials comes, you know, we should not shrink away. We should think of it as God continuing to strengthen us for his work. And that saltiness, you know, Jesus said, of course, in Sermon of the Mount, that we are the salt of the earth. That saltiness will make a difference wherever we are, in every company, in every place. Far from leading others into sin, we'll be given the right example and pointing others in the right direction, that is pointing them to Jesus. And that is the kind of people we are to be. And if that salt is in us, which brings the thirst in others for knowing Christ, then indeed we'll be able to live at peace with one another. And of course Jesus is speaking to his disciples here, because they've been quarreling with each other to see who will be the greatest. So we are to be the kind of persons who lead others to Christ, not lead them in the opposite direction. And even for ourselves, we too have to be alert. And whatever separates us from being at one with Christ, we must get rid of it. So that is our calling, finally, to be the salt of the earth, to make a difference in the lives of other people, point them to Christ, lead them to Christ, rather than leading them astray, rather than ourselves falling, you know, into error and into sin. So may God help us as we seek to live more and more in the way that He would want us to go. The Lord be with you. And so we continue with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And we pray together the prayer that our Savior has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Now we continue with our collect. And the collect for today is the collect on page 177 for proper 14. Let us pray. Grant us, Lord, we pray, the spirit to think and do always those things that are right, that we who cannot exist without you may by you be enabled to live according to your will, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Master, let me walk with you in closer, dearer company. Oh, Master, let me walk with thee. Oh, let me walk with thee. Shining ray far down the future's broadening way, in peace that only thou canst give, with thee, O Master, let me live. So we continue in prayer. Today we pray for God's church worldwide, for all the leaders of God's church in all the various countries of the world, and for all God's people. And we pray that wherever we may be found, that we will be truly the salt of the earth, and through us and our influence, our flavoring influence, the societies in which we, God's people, live will be more and more blessed by the work and by the ministry and by the life and example of God's people. Pray for the church in our province, the Anglican Church in the province of the West Indies, for our Archbishop Howard, who is also Bishop of Jamaica, for all the bishops of our various dioceses in the province, and especially We pray for Claude, our own bishop in our church, the Anglican Church in the Diocese of Trinidad and Tobago. So we lift up our Bishop Claude for God's continued guidance and blessings. We pray for all our clergy and all our people in this land of ours, Trinidad and Tobago. May we also play our part in making Christ known in the world by the work we do, by the lives we live. Today we lift up all those persons that God has put in authority over us in Trinidad and Tobago, our Prime Minister, our President, members of Parliament, our ministers, all decision makers in every aspect of our national life. We pray for wisdom as they make the decisions that will be for the common good. Today we pray for the people of our country. We pray especially in this COVID situation that we will all come to that understanding that we are all our brother's keeper. Each one of us is responsible, not merely for ourselves. We cannot look at ourselves alone, but we must always consider the general good, the good of our brothers and sisters. May we be guided by that principle as we make the decisions day to day, whether to vaccinate or not, whether to wear a mask or not, whether to go certain places or not. May God continue to guide us in this respect. And we pray for those in our country who have suffered from this COVID-19 pandemic in one way or another, for those who have lost loved ones, for those who have become ill themselves and are still fighting for to return to health. We pray for them. We pray for those who work to bring healing to the patients. We pray for those in our Ministry of Health who guide and direct our response to this COVID-19 virus pandemic, and we pray for continued guidance and wisdom upon them. Today we pray for the families of our nation, the homes in which our people live. We pray for parents and that they will be responsible and wise in the bringing up of their children. We pray especially for those homes where there is strife, and we pray for God's peace will be present. For those homes where there is not the means to provide properly for their children, their material and spiritual needs, we pray that others, family and friends, and the church will be very present in these situations to lend a very important helping hand. Before young people, growing up with all kinds of distractions and all kinds of negative influences, we pray for the guidance of their parents and their elders, especially in regard to our gospel today, that as adults and parents, church people, that we will not be the means by which these young people might be led astray, but rather, like salt in the earth, we will be able to put the right flavor and direction into their lives, that they will come to know God and to live their lives and to grow into their full potential. So we pray for all those who are sick and suffering today and crying out for their, for healing and relief in their particular situations. We pray for those in all kinds of situations of suffering, those who have been abused by others who are more powerful than themselves. We pray especially for children who are being abused by adults, sexually and physically. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For all those crying out in their need today, Father, we pray that you send help and assistance, so that they might be relieved, Lord, of the burdens of their life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we pray on page 47, the prayer of dedication. Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of your holy word. May it be a lantern to our feet, a light to our paths, and a strength to our lives. Take us and use us to love and serve all persons in the power of the Holy Spirit. And in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forevermore. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.